Okay, hello everyone. Welcome again to my vlog. As you can see, I have another guest this time. This gentleman's name is Curtis Quick. He's a friend from school here that I work with. And today we're going to be talking about Presbyterian Christianity, something that's a very popular denomination here in Taiwan. But whether you know about Presbyterianism or not, today you're going to get to learn more about that. And also, what does it mean to be an elder at a Presbyterian church? An elder, right? Does that mean just old, or is there more of a positional job significance to that term?
Old.
And elder. Old. Also, usually elders are old as well, even if you're in the position of an elder, I guess. But I don't want to, I talk all the time, and so this time I want to give more of the time over to Curtis. And so, Curtis, one question I have for you is, you're from the United States, right?
That's right. I'm from a long line of Pasadenans.
Oh, really?
We go back at least two generations, maybe even three.
Okay. I thought you were from, was it Bellflower or?
Bellflower, California.
Okay, well, I didn't know that you were from.
That's where I was in middle school, and junior high, and high school.
Okay. I went to Temple City High School, and I went to Oak Avenue Junior High. Do you know of those?
No, I don't.
I mean, it's next to Pasadena.
Okay.
But I mean, I had friends that went to South Pass from my church.
Yeah. Now, I claim to be from a long line of Pasadenans because my father was born in Pasadena.
Wow. Okay.
And so that's my history. That I go back at least two generations.
Amazing.
Yeah. Amazing. Really far back. You know?
Okay. Was the Huntington Library, like, young during that time? Was it around? Was it already developed and created?
The Huntington Library was a healthy library.
Okay.
My father spent time there. I never did, because remember, I didn't live in Pasadena.
Okay.
I was the son of the man from Pasadena.
All right.
And so I grew up in areas like Lakewood and Bellflower. Actually, before that, I was in Sylmar in San Fernando Valley.
Sylmar?
I was
Wow. Learning all these new things about you, Curtis. We've hung out so many times.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Yeah, I know Sylmar. Yeah, isn't that where St. Jude's is over there?
St. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, St. Jude's Children's Hospital.
Yeah, near the 210 and where the 5 hit? Or,
that's right. Okay. Hopefully not too violently either.
Yes.
But sometimes that does
The traffic happen. Is quite violent there. Yes.
And I was saved.
You're saved.
I became a Christian at Foothill Baptist Church, which is in Sylmar, in San Fernando Valley.
Okay. Oh, so you got saved at a Baptist church.
Yeah. I was 10 years old.
I commend you.
I was 10 years old, and the Sunday school teacher, a really kind gentleman, he took me aside after Sunday school class. He says, "What do you think of all that we've been talking about?" I said, "Oh," I responded. I said, I think it's pretty good.
Nice.
Do you agree with it? He said, "Yeah, I agree. I think it's correct." "Well, have you ever talked to God about this?" And I said, "No." He says, "Well, don't you think you might want to tell God what you think about this?"
Very cool.
And so I did, right then and there. We prayed, and I just expressed who I was and who God is and my trust in Jesus. Who I was as a sinner and my trust in Jesus to save me. Because that's what the Sunday school teacher we've been talking about for months.
Okay.
And so
like a gospel unit.
Exactly.
Right.
And so this was the perfect opportunity for me to reflect and pray about it and talk with God about what it means to, you know, trust in Jesus, because that's the only way.
Right.
That's the only way one gets to heaven is by trusting in Jesus, because the Bible says we're all sinners. Every single one of us is a sinner, and none of us can get to heaven. Jesus said, or Jesus answered, a person asked Jesus, "How do I get to heaven?"
Right.
And Jesus said, "You have to be perfect like your Heavenly Father."
Mm.
Well,
yeah, how's that possible?
Yeah, I mean, how many people do you know, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know anyone who's perfect. Certainly, I'm not perfect, and I don't think you and there are perfect either, if I could break the third wall.
Sure, break the third wall.
No one is.
Always.
And so, according to Jesus, nobody gets to heaven. No one. Zero. It doesn't matter what you do and how well you do it. You do not get to heaven. No one does, unless you're perfect. Except for one option. And that's the whole purpose of creation, why God creates the universe, and why Jesus comes to this earth, is to make that option available for us.
Hmm.
Jesus comes into this world and he lays down his life to pay the penalty for our sin. So that if we trust in Jesus, that we have the benefit of what Jesus did for us.
Correct.
And
his righteousness.
Yes, his righteousness given to us to make us righteous. Now that doesn't mean I'm not a sinner anymore. I'm still a sinner, although less, I think over time God has helped me to be less a sinner and more trying to follow Jesus.
Correct.
But I mean, hey, I'm still human, I still sin. It's just not as big of a habit as it was when I was
right.
a kid, I suppose.
Yeah.
And so
hopefully there's been some spiritual maturity.
That's right.
Yeah.
You see, you don't get to heaven by doing good things. You don't get to heaven by doing right things. That's not how you get to heaven. That's how you become more like Jesus.
Mm.
And that's a great thing to do. But that's not how you get to heaven. You get to heaven by trusting in Jesus to save you from your sins. And when you trust in Jesus to save you for your sins, his death works to cover your sins and enable you to, you know, make that blessed transition when you get hit by a bus or however you go to heaven. You know, whatever mechanism you get to heaven.
What an example there, Curtis.
You know, that's the truth.
Knock on wood.
You got to get to heaven some way. Could be a bus, could be an airplane, could be a bullet in the back of the head.
The bus is a very apt analogy for Taiwan, especially Taipei. Yes.
Oh, hey, you know, that transitions us a bit when you said that. Because my first experience in Asia was not in Taiwan, but was in mainland China.
Mm.
Now, you mustn't let me forget this bus thing.
I must not.
Because it's going to take me a while to get there.
Sure.
Okay.
I imperatively will not.
Because I want to share how I got to China. How I got to Taiwan.
Okay.
And I got to Taiwan through, well, I want to say this. A flash of light and a phone call from God. That's how I got to Taiwan. Although that's not
okay.
the first.
You're going to have to explain that.
Time. Indeed, I do. This is a story I love to tell. And I was a student at the California State University of Sacramento.
Mm.
Sorry, California State University at Sacramento. And I was studying physics. And in the winter of 1984-85, there we go. Just dating myself tremendously. In the winter,
it's not that far. Come on, I was still alive.
Good,
know.
Yeah. In the winter of 84-85.
I was playing video games.
I guess it was in between Christmas and New Year's. So it was very much 84-85. And I was in Chicago with friends who had spent tons of money. We'd saved up all semester to go to the Urbana Student Missions Convention,
nice. Yeah.
which was in Urbana, Illinois.
Right.
And what was it? It's nearly 20,000 students from all over the United States would converge on the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign campus. And we would hear missionaries from all over the world in large venues and small and everything in between talk about missions.
Right.
And the whole goal of the Urbana Missions Convention is to help students like myself get the vision for going out and helping others to come to know Christ and to get saved. And so I went to this conference thinking this is going to be great because, man, I'm traveling. This is the first time I took an airplane ride. Was from Sacramento to Illinois. And it was awesome. Actually, it was San Francisco, as I recall, to Illinois. And it was awesome. And we got to Illinois and then took this long old bus ride to get from the airport, O'Hare, down to Urbana-Champaign. And I didn't look at a map. I assumed it was in downtown Chicago for all I knew. Ha! It was like 4 hours on the bus going south. And we get there and this is huge, wonderful, beautiful campus. And all these Christian folks everywhere.
Nice.
And we're going to these sessions, the big plenary session with, you know, 19,000 of your best friends all there. And it's a great thing to worship God in that environment and to hear from tremendous speakers like Eric Alexander, who spoke with his tremendous a Scottish accent. It was tremendous to hear him
who
talk.
Who were the great speakers of the 80s? Because I didn't become a Christian until 89, and so I know who the popular evangelical speakers were in the 90s and the 2000s, but back then, who were they?
Well,
I mean, you find them, a lot of them, at Urbana, because they're the ones that are invited.
I suppose, right? Some of them aren't around anymore. I mean, Billy Graham made a drop in.
Cool.
Louis Palau
was
around. And of course, as I said, Eric Alexander. And different, for the most part, reformed folk. Reformed? What does that mean?
Yeah.
Well, this is a little bit of a...
It relates to Presbyterianism.
It relates to Presbyterianism.
Yeah.
And it turns out that I was involved with InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, which is, in fact, the group that puts together Urbana. And Urbana is a bit of a reformed organization. Mm-hmm. And I think it really is spiritually very Presbyterian, but you won't find any Presbyterianism explicitly defined as a definition of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, which is, by the way, a college student organization,
right,
of Christians. And so the people who they invited to Urbana, and there were lots of the missionaries, but there were also these great preachers like Eric Alexander. We were going through the book of Ephesians, and it's tremendous to go through the book of Ephesians with Dr. Eric Alexander, because, I mean, it's very eye-opening. And one of his very famous statements is, prayer isn't... Oh, could I say it in the Scottish brogue?
Sure.
Prayer isn't supplemental, it's fundamental. It's like, whoa.
Yeah.
In other words, prayer isn't something that people like do, you know, like some evening over there, whatever,
right,
you know, when they have nothing else to do.
Right.
It's like, no, it's the boring of the whole, he would say. You know, he would talk about, his example was of people who would create the first train tracks that went over England, and how they would bore holes in the ground and fill them with gunpowder. And then light the gunpowder, and then they would explode out the rock.
Okay.
And that would smooth out the bumps, you know, so you could lay this flat track across. But of course, it takes a long time to do that. And the hard work isn't, I mean, everyone wants to be around when they explode the gunpowder, right? That's the exciting part, the fireworks. But his point was the hard work was boring that hole.
Mm-hmm.
And so he would say he says, prayer is boring the hole. And the fireworks are when, you know, someone decides to believe. But long before someone decides to believe, Eric Alexander would be saying that the people were boring the hole.
Right, right.
That caused that person, boring the hole maybe into their heart, as it were,
right,
through prayer.
Mm.
So that God would be speaking to that person maybe long in advance of their decision to believe,
right,
and to trust in Jesus.
Yeah.
And so everyone thinks, oh man, it's just that date, that moment when they believe, and the answer is, of course, it really is everything that,
right,
leads up to that.
It's God is the pre-evangelism of prayer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's, you know, what Paul says about, naturally we're all spiritually dead, and we can't respond to the truths in the Bible, the truths of Christ. We just can't. It's impossible. And so we might even hear the words of the Bible, but we won't believe them. Until God's Spirit works in our heart to wake us up, to enliven us, to make our souls no longer dead, but to make our souls open,
right,
to God's truth. And then we respond naturally to the truths of the gospel that people would think is just utter foolishness, but it's not. It's not foolishness at all. It's a profound truth.
Mm.
And it's that truth that pulled me to Urbana, and that truth that took me onward to China, but I haven't gotten there yet. Okay, so during the main sessions at Urbana, the speakers are talking about how God is working in various places in the world. And a lot of attention was on Africa, and I was kind of thinking, wow, God's really working in Africa. Maybe I should go to Africa. Maybe I should be a missionary. And before going to Urbana, I wasn't thinking, should I be a missionary or shouldn't I? That really wasn't the question. The question was where and how.
Mm.
And so that was really my focus when I was going. You know, dear God,
okay,
was my prayer. Show me where and how.
So you already had a missions calling before you...
You know, I wouldn't... well...
Like right now, you're a college counselor, right? So,
right.
But then you, that actually wasn't your initial idea of what you wanted to be.
Well, you know, my initial idea of what I wanted to be was to be an astronomer for God.
Okay.
I thought I would be an astronomer because I love astronomy.
Yeah.
And I studied astronomy and I love physics and I studied physics. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to be a Christian astronomer.
Sure.
And notice that the word Christian is an adjective modifying astronomer.
Hmm.
That's a mistake, you see, because I'm a Christian who might be an astronomer if I was one. I'm a Christian, not an astronomer who's a Christian, but a Christian who happens to study astronomy.
Right. Right.
There needs to be that sense. And this is not just semantics, but I realized that I needed to be a Christian first and then everything else second.
Right.
And I don't recall if I heard that at Urbana or at one of the many good conferences I was at before, good intervarsity conferences I was at before Urbana. But certainly by the time I got to Urbana, I realized that we're all missionaries.
True.
We're all called to be missionaries in one way or another. And the answer is, you know, where and how.
I didn't have an answer
to that. But at Urbana, I was learning about where and how that could happen. And a lot of the emphasis of a lot of the different missionaries was that the where could be anywhere God is calling you. Hmm. And it could even be the United States for me. It could even still be the United States. And so, okay, so the where is not maybe the big question, the big deal. The bigger deal was how. And the big suggestion that was mentioned over and over by different speakers in different venues was that, well, you could do it right now as a student. You could go and have a missions experience or even long-term experience. You could start right now and go as a student. And in some places, you could go as a student and you could teach English or something. And then you could share the gospel, maybe in some places inside the classroom or in some places outside the classroom, you know, if depending upon the circumstance. And I said, that makes sense. I like that. And the concept of not so much preaching the gospel, but being a Christian friend and sharing the gospel as a friend seemed very appealing to me because I didn't really see myself as much of a preacher. It's kind of scary. Although I have
Which is kind of funny because pretty much for the past 10 minutes, it sounds like preaching to me. I think you'd be a great preacher, honestly.
Well,
and that relates to the whole Presbyterian elder thing.
Oh, also. Yeah. Yeah, you know what? I'm going to skip forward to that because it's a funny story.
Okay, go for it.
The pastor of my Presbyterian church had to go away for a meeting or a conference or something.
Right.
And so in his absence, he asked me to fill the pulpit.
Yes, of course.
He asked me to preach in his absence, and I was very happy to do so. Mm-hmm. But I was telling him, you know, I'm not real trained in this. He said, you'll do fine. You'll do fine. And so he goes off on his missions trip or whatever
right.
it was. And then he comes back and he watches the video. And he says, you know, I left this part out. I said to him when he asked me, I said, you know, I think I'm more of a teacher than a preacher. And he said, no, you'll be fine.
Okay.
Sure. And so he comes back, he watches the video. And he says, you know, I think you were more teaching it than preaching it.
Hmm.
And I said, duh.
Which is exactly what you just said, right? You warned him.
And so I did enjoy preaching, but it was clear that it wasn't something that I was ready for in the sense that, you know, you have your stories lined up and your amusing anecdotes mm-hmm. and then you have your scriptural passages and
right.
all this stuff and how it all works together.
Right.
And mostly I was just doing what I did when I was in a Baptist church. Okay,
right.
to go back to my Baptist
roots.
When I was at Lakewood, First Baptist Church of Lakewood, which had a pastor from BIOLA.
Of course.
The Bible Institute of Los Angeles.
Yes.
Pastor James A. Bohr. Now, what a bummer of a name. I mean, gosh.
Pastor
Bohr. Pastor Bohr.
Nice.
But he wasn't a Bohr. He was actually really quite different from most Baptist preachers. He was the church is an American Baptist church, also called Swedish Baptist if you're in the upper Midwest. And it tends to be less Southern Baptist by leaps and bounds. which means that the preaching tends not to be the pastor telling stories, but it tends to be the pastor being like giving good exegesis,
right,
good scriptural exegesis. So the pastor's teaching, the teaching,
right,
that word again, teaching, yeah, the scriptures. And it was not uncommon on Sunday morning for me as a high school student,
right,
to see the pastor writing out the Greek words for this particular. I mean, he showed this. He had an overhead projector. This is long before computers.
Right.
He preached with an overhead projector.
Yes.
I mean, this is my experience growing,
yeah,
up.
Yeah.
And he had the verses printed out in English, and then he'd write in the Greek underneath, interlinear style. And he'd talk about the tenses of the verbs. And it was amazing because this was a large church, and I'm fascinated.
Yeah, yeah. You don't really see that.
There was like hundreds and hundreds of people,
yeah,
there Sunday morning listening to him parse Greek verbs. I mean, it was tremendous. And of course, I then really appreciated this because I was already into science, and Greek is the language of science practically.
Hmm.
I mean, when you study science and you look at various equations,
that's
of
right,
science,
you see
what
Greek,
do you see?
Yeah.
You see Greek symbols,
yeah,
all over the place. So I thought, oh, that's cool.
That's very cool.
And then later on, years later, I would actually take New Testament Greek in university, at a public,
yes,
university.
Yes.
I was like, wow. And it was awesome because I already knew the sounds of the word, or sounds,
yes,
of the letters. You know, I knew the Greek alphabet because of why? Because of science. Mm-hmm. I love science. And so it made New Testament Greek very accessible to me, and I loved it. But to get back to China...
By the way, you were describing how your American Baptist pastor was preaching, that sounds like what a Presbyterian would do.
You know what? I have come to think that he would have been a great Presbyterian,
yeah,
preacher, actually.
Was he a Calvinist too?
I believe he was.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you something. I did not know what a Calvinist was when I was a young man. I did not know until after I discovered I was a Calvinist. Okay? I was a Calvinist.
After the fact.
I was a Calvinist without knowing it.
Yeah.
What are you? I just didn't know that I was a Calvinist. Because in my upbringing, I did not hear about Calvin.
Hmm.
And I knew of Calvin. I knew that he was a reformer. But I didn't really know what Calvinism was. I knew what I believed. And I knew what I had been taught. And it turned out that I learned what Calvinism was. This is fantastic. I did not know the Calvinist doctrines as Calvinist.
Mm.
I knew the doctrines. I just didn't know they were Calvinism.
Right.
Okay. I knew, for instance, in Calvinism, there is a wonderful set of there's a wonderful mnemonic in Calvinism called Tulip.
Mm.
Tulip is, of course, a flower. And it's my favorite flower, truth be told.
There it is.
However, it's not because of the appearance or the aroma of the flower.
Hmm.
I love the tulip because of what it represents. Because of what T-U-L-I-P represents. And this is pure Calvinism, but I didn't know it.
Hmm.
I was taught the tulip as a student in InterVarsity.
Oh.
You know, so I learned that T for total depravity,
okay, yeah,
and
yeah,
U for unconditional election, mm-hmm, and the L for limited atonement, and the I for irresistible grace, and the P for the perseverance of the saints.
There it is, yeah.
That's TULIP, and
yeah,
I believed it, and I thought that's awesome. What a great way to realize the truths of Christianity and what it takes to believe in Christianity. And then later on I learned there are some people, and this blew my mind, there are some people who thought that was incorrect.
Mm.
I thought, what? Why? It's such a great way of organizing the truths of the gospel. Why wouldn't you? It's like somebody cutting off their legs. Why would you? You could do that, but why would you want to? And yet there are those out there. There are Christian folks out there who think that Calvinism is somehow of the devil or something. I mean, they think it's like anti-Christian.
Yeah.
I don't get that. I don't understand that. That's like beyond my capability to fathom. But there are some. I don't know. Maybe they're Donald Trump fans? I don't know. And they think that Calvinism is of the devil. I don't know. But that's cruel. I apologize. I take that back. That was unfair.
You know, Donald Trump is a Presbyterian.
You know, there are problems in the Presbyterian church.
So, I don't think that they would be non-Calvinists. Although, I don't think Donald Trump would even know what Tulip would be. Well, who knows? Maybe.
Well, Donald Trump's never read the Bible. I don't know how he could be a Christian if he'd never read the Bible. Or any part of the Bible.
Well,
in fact,
I think he has
read parts
of the Bible. I mean, he knows 1 Corinthians.
I guess it's a picture book or something, maybe. Maybe it's the Bible for children.
No, because there's a connection between him and also the Hebrides revival during the Lewis Awakening of the 1950s. Like, he actually inherited one of the Bibles from that Great Awakening from one of his ancestors who moved to America.
And did he hold it the right way up?
No, but I think that he did have some biblical education. Although, I would question whether he's read through much of the Bible, but who knows? You know.
Well, I digress totally. And I'm
sorry,
this is
a total digression.
This rabbit hole. But I would say this, just to make real quick, boy, we really are.
We're all over the place. Yeah.
But Presbyterianism is not monolithic. Hmm. It's not one thing. Presbyterian does mean, in the New Testament Greek, presbyteros means rule by the old folks. That's what Presbyterian means. And so there is a system of church governance in Presbyterianism where there is a group of elders who tend to be old, and they are the ones who are called by their congregation to seek God's guidance and provide spiritual guidance for the church, spiritual oversight over the church.
And that's one of the distinctives of Presbyterianism.
That is a distinctive of Presbyterianism, which is a different form of church governance than a lot of other denominations practice, good or bad. And so Presbyterianism has the leadership as a group of people who are chosen by their congregation and given the responsibility to pray, seek God's guidance, and provide spiritual oversight over the church that they're living at.
Right.
That is the basic governing body of a Presbyterian church. Mm-hmm. And then the what they call the session, or this board of elders, the session of the church then calls someone or someones to be staff for the church. Well, I guess it would normally be multiple people to be church staff, like the pastor or assistant pastor, associate pastor, or the church secretary, or maybe ministers of various leaders of various ministries, like the music ministry, or a missions director, or a whole bunch of different offices of the church. The session is supposed to nominate these officers and then bring that nomination to the congregation, and the congregation would elect their church officers that the session has brought forth to them to vote on.
Okay.
Of course, normally it's a bit of a rubber stamp. I mean, the session is supposed to do their homework. They're supposed to pray, seek God's guidance, and interview, and consider, and pray more, and seek God's guidance more, and maybe interview again, and come up with a really good sense of the Holy Spirit's direction, hopefully. I mean, that's the idea, that the session would be really in touch with what God is doing, particularly at the church, and be able to of one mind. And that's the key of the session. The session doesn't actually do things. The members of the elder board, the session, they don't do anything by vote of a majority.
Okay.
They do by consensus vote. So if someone is saying, I don't feel good about this, then generally speaking, they'll not do it.
Right.
That's a tough one. But the idea is that if a board of elders on a session is really listening to the Holy Spirit, the idea is the Holy Spirit speaks with one voice, or should. And so they should continue talking about it, about an issue, until they have one voice about that matter.
Right.
And then once that happens, and sometimes it takes forever to happen,
because
we all have different opinions.
Especially the more people you have in the session.
Right, and generally you don't have a lot. Maybe 5, 6, or 7 or something. Not too big of a session, because it does get unwieldy. And sometimes within this milieu of an elder board, you have different elders who will actually focus on certain ministries in the church. And so I was an elder, and I like to focus on the worship ministry.
Yes.
And other elders were maybe focusing on the church business and finance, or maybe they'd focus on missions, or maybe they'd focus on Sunday school or something like this. And there's another in the Presbyterian Church. There's another body called the Board of Deacons, and the right. Board of Deacons' job is to be directed by the elders to do things,
okay,
to care for the church, the physical well-being of the church. The elders are more concerned with the spiritual well-being, and we call the deacons in Presbyterianism. Hmm. The deacons are called to deal with the physical needs of the church.
Right.
So when there are church activities, the deacons would be the ones planning them and carrying them out.
Okay.
When there are people in the congregation with need, the deacons would be meeting with those people and caring for them and maybe distributing funds to them. Usually the session would not know about such things. We would try to stay as far away from... Usually the session wants to stay as far away from funding as we can.
Okay.
As possible. The session might be praying a lot about, you know, someone's been someone's ill. We pray for them. Maybe we'll even meet with them and put our hands on them and pray for them. Or maybe a family's having marital problems, and so we're praying for the husband and wife. We don't normally meet with the husband and wife. The pastor's probably doing that, mm-hmm. or the associate or assistant pastor. But the pastor does have a report to give the session about the spiritual condition of the congregation, and so we'll pray about that in the midst of the session meeting. And give what we feel is God's direction to the pastor, to as he's dealing with individuals that he's meeting with, individual members of the congregation that he's meeting with. And so, in fact, when I joined the church, I was in a membership class where, what do you know, they used the tulip.
Oh, okay.
Go, oh, how nice. I saw this before.
And that's when you realize it's part of Calvinism.
Actually, no. Even then, I didn't. Even then, I didn't. But I was then, a few months later, or maybe 6 months later, after being at the church for that time, I was asked by the elders if I would consider becoming a deacon.
Mm.
I said, sure, but I did have to commute to church. I said, that's a bit of an issue. I lived in Taoyuan at the time.
Hmm.
And so I'd have to get my way to the church and then go back.
Okay, let's put a hold on this. I mean, I do want to talk about this, but let's get some background.
Right.
So connect the dots between you being in America and then coming over to Taiwan and then starting a life here.
Okay, back to the old story of a flash of light and a phone call from God. All right, I'm in university. I had been to Urbana,
okay.
And at Urbana, I was convinced I should go into, even before Urbana, but Urbana cemented this, that I really should go into missions, but I still wasn't sure of where or what or how. However, after the Urbana Missions Convention, the following month, just before school started up again, because we're in the winter break, just before school, or maybe a week after, it's like right at the beginning of the second semester, all over the country, they had small meetings called Urbana Onward conferences, where you would get together with some people who went to from Urbana, but really with most of the people in your student fellowship that didn't go to Urbana.
Okay.
And then you'd also invite a missionary or two or three, I think it was three, that came to our Urbana Onward conference. It was a weekend conference. And we had a great time. And I listened to a wonderful older gentleman. His name was David Aideney, and he was sharing with us about the church's long march in China. Now that's an interesting way to refer to it, because in communist Chinese history there is something called the long march, when Chairman Mao Zedong, well, I suppose that's before he was chairman, when he was leading the troops long before communist China took over mainland. Mm-hmm. But when he was leading his troops through the mountains, there was this long march that went over thousands of kilometers. And I suppose a lot of people died of freezing cold and whatnot, as they were going over mountains and everything. But in any case, David Aideney spoke of the growth of the church. He was an InterVarsity Christian Fellowship staff worker at a university in Shanghai in the 1940s, 50s. In the 1950s, excuse me. before China was completely taken over by the communists.
Right.
All right. So, but at some point, the communists did take over, and they ordered all the foreigners out, especially all the missionaries, all the university Christian fellowship staff workers. And he was really sad to leave. He was in his 20s. And as he's leaving, he's thinking, man, this is sad. This is totally closing the door on China.
Yeah.
And the few who are left, you know, they'll be... There are so many thousands of Christians, maybe a million or so in China, and they'll be exterminated.
Hmm.
And it's a horrible thing. And he left, sadly, and was in Hong Kong. And then the Cultural Revolution happened. And then he try to keep in touch with people, but over time, fewer and fewer people could actually communicate with him. For whatever reason. Maybe they'd been executed, or maybe they were in prison, or maybe they had just passed away for whatever reason. Right? So it's a black time period, in the sense that we just didn't know what's going on in China.
Right. Before the internet and social media.
That's right.
So literally just letter writing or the old-fashioned landline.
If such things worked. Mm. And in many cases, they did not.
Mm.
During the Chinese Cultural Revolution, this was a big issue. And so it wasn't until the end of the Cultural Revolution that there was really any kind of good communication into China. And so he tried to communicate, to get in touch with anybody who he knew. And he managed to get information. And what he found out was startling. That during the Cultural Revolution, of course, there was tremendous persecution against Christians. But it seemed that now there were 10 times as many Christians in China as when he had left.
Yeah.
Christianity was blossoming. It was growing.
It blew up.
It was quite an explosion of Christianity. And why was this? Because the assumption was, of course, that people would flee from Christianity because it was a good reason to get yourself killed. And certainly if you were a Christian, you would be... in disfavor, if not in prison, and certainly even if not in disfavor, you wouldn't get a good position in university or in a school or in a business. And so the feeling was that because of these issues, Christianity was not going to grow. And of course, it was quite the opposite.
Mm.
The famous statement for, I don't know, thousands of years, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church.
Mm.
And there are many martyrs in China. I'm not saying it was easy for Christians in China, by no means. They were persecuted and killed.
Yes.
But as they died, they gave praise to God. And people saw that. And it gave people hope. Because they saw people being persecuted and still having hope. And not giving up. And they turned to believe in Christ because of it. It's a powerful witness. Martyrdom is a powerful witness. I'm not saying you should all go and get martyred or anything. But it's a powerful witness. Because if you believe in something, you believe in Christ... enough to actually allow yourself to be persecuted for it, this is serious.
Mm-hmm.
Because everyone nobody wants to get persecuted. I don't recommend it as a life vocation. But if someone understands, and everyone does understand how terrible persecution is, and yet they're still willing to stand firm for their beliefs, that's a powerful testimony.
Very.
And a lot of people hear it, and they become Christian because of it. Because in our life, in mainland China, in the Cultural Revolution time period and beyond, it's a terrible time for everybody, whether you're a Christian or not, unless you're one of the evil leaders who is loving it. You know, if you love, you know, if you get off on hurting people, I suppose it's a great time. But, you know, what goes around comes around, and those people get punished too.
Oh, yeah.
So the average person who's not in a position of authority, but, you know, being, he's underneath the thumb of the... you know, the fascists or the communists, whatever, that person is hurting and is scared.
Mm.
And when they meet somebody who's maybe hurting but not so scared because they have Christ and they have faith in Jesus, that makes a big difference.
They wonder why.
They wonder why.
Mm-hmm.
And when they hear why, they go, you know, life is so uncertain. I think I better believe in what you're believing, because otherwise, I mean, what do I got?
Yeah, yeah.
And the answer is nothing.
Yeah.
And having Christ is everything. And it makes it possible, you know. Having Christ does make it possible for us to face great difficulty, because Christ is there. And not so much to end the difficulty, although, you know, God's mercy is wonderful in that regard, but more so to be with us in the midst of the difficulty. Mm-hmm. So that Christ is there lifting us up, holding us up, helping us to realize that we are not alone. Okay, so I still haven't told you how I got to China.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so anyway, I'm listening to David Aidney.
Taiwan.
I'm listening to David Aidney speak, and he's like enthralling. You know, he's in his 70s or 80s, but he's glowing.
Mm.
He's full of energy. He is like an angel. I mean, in the sense that his words are so wonderful to hear. And the story he's telling about China is riveting, and it's awesome, and it's drawing us in. And there's like 100 of us in the room. I'm thinking, wow, this is tremendous. And then he said, "But and you know, right now, it may be possible for you to go."
Hmm.
I'm thinking, wow, tell me. Well, you could go as a student. That's the same words, the same similar words that I heard at Urbana, but I wasn't really listening as carefully to that. And so I knew the place, and I knew how, well, in some ways how, as a student. And I was very excited.
That's
awesome. But I didn't actually know how I was going to actually get to China. Okay, so back at school, it's now summertime. Oh, well, but before summer. Okay, this is wintertime when we got back, and I heard from David Aidney, and I really understood that I should go to China.
Hmm.
Okay, but how, I wasn't too certain. At Urbana, I knew I should go, but I didn't know where. At Urbana onward, I knew where. I really felt strongly. So what did I do? Well, I switched churches. I joined a Chinese Grace Bible Church, actually, in the Sacramento area. And I started to hang out with Chinese Christians, just so I could begin to understand some of the cultural differences. Not that most of these Chinese Christians were any more Chinese than I, except in appearance. But they, of course, were more familiar because their parents were very much more culturally Christian. There was ABC as they come.
Yeah.
But their parents certainly were not. And so they were that much closer to Chinese culture. So when I would share with them my excitement, they would be able to help me, to inform me a little bit more about Chinese culture.
When you went to their church, did you tell them your intentions?
Like, yes.
The reason why is because you wanted to become a missionary.
That's right. I told the pastor, and they understood. And other people in the church, whenever I had the opportunity, I would tell. Because why? Another reason why I would tell them is because I'm sending out letters to try and raise support. Because I want to go to China, but I didn't know how to go to China. I mean, actually, wait a minute. This is before the letters. The letters come a little bit later. Okay. So here comes summertime. All right. And summertime is a time for me to read. I love to read. So I was in the library at the Cal State Sacramento library, big old library, and I'm reading Aviation Week and Space Technology in the in 1985, summer of 85.
Nice.
And because I love all things that, you know, space related, and reading all about the space shuttle and such things, and missions to the planets by robot probes that are photographing things that have never been seen before, and I'm enthralled. And then flash. There's this flash of light while I'm reading this magazine. I look up, and there's this young lady aiming a camera at me. She took my picture. And she said, "Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to disturb you. I'm taking slides to take back with me to China to teach my students." And I said, "Please sit down."
Yes.
I want to hear all about it. So for the next hour and a half, she told me everything about how she was in China, how she was a Christian teaching students at university in a Chinese university all about English, but also using the Bible and other such Christian texts, and sharing about Jesus with Chinese people. And she was working for a missions organization that was sending teachers to China, called the English Language Institute, ELI, English Language Institute for China, ELIC.
Yeah.
And I was pretty excited.
Yeah.
And so finally, I could bridge that gap to China. I knew it was possible. I knew someone. And I said, "Can you connect me with your organization? Because I really want to go."
Wow.
And I shared with her where I'd been. And so she understood. And she said, "Sure." And so she took my phone number and name, and so she was going to pass it on to her boss and their boss and get to the head office, and they were going to get in touch with me. And this is great. I floated home happy as a clam. I knew there was a way.
Nice.
And after I got home, there's this phone call.
Great.
And my roommate answered, and they were asking for me. And he said, this is for you. I thought, really? Who'd be calling me? And I said, hello. And there was two questions. I said, you're Curtis Quick, right? Well, that was actually not one of those questions. But anyway, that's a question. And I said, yeah. He said, are you interested in teaching English? I said, sure. Would you like to... Actually, the first question was, would you like to go to China? I said, yes.
Yes.
Are you willing to teach English? I said, sure. They said, well, we got a spot for you. Hmm. We're the Educational Services Exchange with China.
Huh.
A different
wow.
organization, completely unrelated to this young lady. That was my phone call from God.
Hmm.
Because I'll tell you, they did not have my phone number and my name from that young lady who had just spoke with me hours before. How did they get my name?
Yeah, how did they get it?
Turns out, because I asked him, because I was amazed at the end of the talk. I said, how did you guys get my name and phone number? And I said, well, or they said, well, we got it from Urbana. It was on a list. It was on a list of people interested in China, in teaching English in China. And we were going through our list, and you were on the list, and we called you tonight. And I was saying, wow, because I don't remember signing up for China or for teaching English. Even though I was, I guess I signed a lot of different things. Indicated my interest in lots of different things.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, but honestly, I asked you this. I just spoke to the girl in the library at the university a few hours before. And the phone rings from a different organization.
Hmm.
And they want to talk to me about teaching English in China.
That seems to me too much of a coincidence.
Come on.
To be random, yeah. It's a God moment.
And they said, are you ready to go? And I said, well, actually, I haven't graduated yet. They said, okay then. You're going to graduate first. We'll put you on our mailing list. You'll get a monthly newsletter. You can read all about us, but we're not going to send you until you graduate with your degree. Oh, okay. And click. They hung up, saying goodbye, you know. And what do you know? They put me on the mailing list. And every month I got a newsletter. And that was pretty awesome. And I really appreciated getting those newsletters because it was all about teachers in China, American teachers in China teaching Christian teachers. Teaching students, university students in China.
Hmm.
And I was just excited. And then a year goes by, and I finish up my classes. So now we're in 1986, and no, actually, 85. You know what? I didn't go till 87. So maybe my Urbana must be, oh, I forget how this works. Anyway.
It's a while back.
It's a while back, and yeah, the cobwebs are thick. But in any case, 1 year goes by, and they call me up, and they say, have you graduated?
So they're pretty persistent.
They are.
Wow.
They kept in touch with me.
Yeah, and they keep records, too.
They keep records, and they called me up, and I said, I've graduated. And they said, well, let's get you down to the U.S. Center for World Missions in Pasadena.
Mm.
And so after graduating and moving
I've been there before.
That's a good. Yeah. Actually, we were across the street from the U.S. Center. We were at the William Carey Institute.
Okay, yeah.
So after finishing at the Cal State Sacramento in my with my degree in physics, then I moved on down to Pasadena, and I was involved in the Educational Services Exchange with China, or ESEC, program for training about, I don't know, 70 or 80 of us to go as teachers to mainland China. And it was quite the experience, I'll tell you. They did a lot of stuff there to play with our brain, actually. They wouldn't tell us when meetings would occur often, or they wouldn't solve problems for us. They just said, well, you guys figure it out. Like we're really, like it was summertime, and we were really hot in our rooms, and they wouldn't give us fans.
Well, it sounds very similar to a certain job that we are very familiar with.
Well, I'll tell you what. On the last day of training, they said, guys, you've had a lot of requests that we have not honored. We have not given you the things you've asked for or explained to you things that you've had questions about. And that was not by mistake.
Mm.
We very much wanted to give you an opportunity to be frustrated as much as possible.
Mm.
Because, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to the land of frustration.
Yeah.
where you have absolutely no control over anything. And we wanted you to get better at being out of...
So that was part of the training.
It's part of the training. Better at not being in control.
Nice.
And they said, we're sorry for the stress that put you through and the pain and the suffering and the anger, but that was meant to help you in the coming months when you go to China. And for some of the teachers in China, they really had it bad.
Yeah, I can imagine.
They had it bad. Now, in my case, we had it pretty good. Our school was really kind to us. We were kind of like the trophy wives kind of thing. Mm. You know, and so they would show us around, and that was pretty cool. They loved that. But other schools, that wasn't the case. And they really had it tough. And some teachers, they left before the year was out. It was just so bad. In our case, we stayed 1.5 years in Guilin, southern China. And then at about wintertime, I transitioned up to Beijing. They had some teachers leave in Beijing, and the program was actually shutting down in Guilin. And so we moved north to the land of warm winters. Hmm. Because you know in Guilin it's freezing. It doesn't snow in Guilin. It doesn't get to be icy in Guilin, but doggone it's cold. Hmm. Guilin is roughly the same latitude as Hong Kong. Hmm. And Hong Kong actually gets pretty cold in the wintertime. The difference is, in Hong Kong, you know, people have heaters inside their homes. Hmm. Not in Guilin.
Yeah.
In Guilin, it's cold outside. It's even colder inside. Welcome to the refrigerator.
Hmm.
That's your apartment block. Big cement refrigerator. And so, we're freezing. I remember coming back from class, standing on a cement floor, teaching classes for a few hours. As time went by, my feet felt more and more numb. And I remember stomping my way back to my apartment building across campus, trying to get some blood flowing into my feet. And then getting back to the apartment building with my parka, my jacket on, doing laps around the coffee table. 25 the other, back and forth, 100 laps to try and warm up. That's what it was like in Guilin.
Wow.
When we moved to Beijing, man, we're in t-shirts practically. It's so hot in the wintertime. What are you talking about? Well, indoors is heating in Beijing. And it's a kind of a forced air heating.
Hmm.
You know, it's like a central heating. And so when the heat goes on, you get hot. And we actually had to open the windows to keep from sweating in Beijing. Hmm. No, mind you, I'm not going to complain. Because when it snowed outside, we were toasty inside. It wasn't bad. And it was great to be able to get out from the cold. And so that worked out pretty well.
Nice.
And I stayed in China for a year and a half. But something happened. Two things happened, actually. In the summer of 1989, it was the best of times. It was the worst of times. Early 1989, I was in Beijing. And boy, was it at the best of times. Students were really excited. People were excited in Beijing. Because why? Because in the fall of 88, communism had collapsed in the Soviet Union.
Hmm.
And people in China were pretty excited.
Yeah.
Because they thought, well, if communism falls there, it could fall here.
Yeah.
And so everyone's pretty excited about the future for China. They were looking forward to a great future.
Yeah.
A future that's, you know, where they had perestroika and glasnost. You know, perestroika is restructuring and glasnost is what? Peace? I forget, glasnost, I don't know. It was what people were saying about the changes in what was the Soviet Union. Now, mind you, a lot of things have changed in Russia. It went fascist. It went from communist to fascist pretty quickly, which is sad. For a time, the people in China were looking at the changes in Russia and thinking, man, all right, it could happen. It could happen in China too. And in many ways, it was going to happen. And it would have probably been different, maybe a lot better in China than it ended up in Russia. Because China really has a good potential future. There's a lot of resources, a lot more resources in China than there are in Russia. And a lot more intelligence, too. That wasn't to be. When the people decided to protest against the government not being willing to modify, to become more democratic, to be more open, to be more liberal. Oh, that's what glasnost is, openness. Perestroika is restructuring, glasnost is openness. So they wanted restructuring and they wanted openness. And the Chinese government said, no way. and they slaughtered people in Tiananmen Square. And I was in Tiananmen Square, not when they slaughtered people, but, you know, in the lead up to it, I was there with thousands of others. I remember looking down the boulevard, seeing an ocean of black as far as the eye could see. And those were all these Chinese folks standing in the street, you know, 100 across and 10,000 down the road, and millions of people. And it was the best of times. And then when the worst of times happened, it was a terrible thing. And I remember hearing gunfire and hearing of students who'd been injured and perhaps killed. And it was very sad. Very, very sad. I did not wish to leave, but eventually the government ordered the foreigners out. Because the old Chinese idiom, you can't discipline the children when the stranger's around. You get rid of the stranger before you beat the children. And so they sent us out. And but I thought my time in China wasn't over. That was the end of my second year. So I returned to Peking University. I'd actually was at a different university before, but when I returned to China, I was now the team leader at Peking University of their English, the foreign English department.
Wow.
And it was an honor, to be sure. And it was still with this Christian organization, so we were still preaching the gospel, so to speak. It was kind of the soft sell. We would do three kinds of English classes in mainland China. One kind was listening and pronunciation, listening and speaking. Another kind was actual grammar class. And a third was American culture. And I'll tell you, we used that, we milked that for all it was worth. We would talk about the Christian heritage in the United States and Christian holidays.
Nice.
And all of what that meant and what's the big deal about Christianity, just because it was a cultural phenomenon, right? And we didn't actually do prayers in class or anything like that, or even invite people to come believe. But you know what? People did come to see us outside of class, and some of those people did come to believe.
Amen.
And so we were thanking God for that.
Yeah.
This is my third year in China. Now, one thing about being a student, a graduate student, or sorry, having graduated university in the United States, some of us can't afford to go to university in the United States on our own income, and so we borrow money to go to school. I did that, and I owed money. And the nice thing is that for 3 years, I had the opportunity to delay my repayment of my student loans.
Okay.
So I had a 3-year grace period. Well, I had been 3 years in China, so the grace period was coming to an end. And the sad truth was that in China, they didn't really pay you with real money, at least not at first. We got monopoly money. Monopoly money is, at the time, China had two currencies, had an internal and an external currency. The internal currency, called renminbi, was not useful outside of China. And so they would pay us in renminbi, and we could buy Coca-Cola, although it tasted pretty weird compared to the Coca-Cola that we're used to. And we could buy snacks. I remember my weekend foray into town was to go find interesting snacks. I'd find a candy bar or maybe some ice cream or something. And then I'd try it and I'd discover, you know, it only looks like a candy bar. No, it looks like it. But that was my entertainment. That's how we entertained ourselves.
The street food of China.
Yes. And it was lots of fun. And over time, we got, we lowered our expectations. You know, so it was more of an entertaining activity than a letdown.
Yeah.
Let's see how they can fool us this time, right? and I'll tell you, it helped the time pass. And there were times when that remedy came in handy. I mean, sometimes you come across a store that has tomato paste. You never see tomato paste in mainland China, so you just buy it all.
Oh.
You pull out as much as you can, you buy everything you can, you take it home, because you know it's not going to be there in a day, even a few hours. Tomato paste, because that's handy if you ever want to make spaghetti or something.
Right?
Or peanut butter.
Peanut
butter is not available in mainland China, so we saw peanut butter on the shelf. We bought it all. 10 jars of peanut butter. You can't eat 10 bars of peanut butter, jars of peanut butter. Well, eventually we ate most of it. We loved it.
Right.
That's what you do. Because the money cannot be taken out of the country. So you spend it on things you can get in the country that can be paid for and enjoyed, hopefully. So that was life in China.
Wow.
But after 3 years, I needed some real money to start repaying my student loans.
Okay.
So I wanted to be in a Chinese environment where I could earn some money.
I see.
And I had friends who had been in China and gone to Taiwan, and they were beckoning me, you know, like the man from Macedonia. It wasn't in my dreams, it was in my letters. They were telling me, come to Taiwan. And so I went to Taiwan.
Now, were you already married at this point? Or
no, I hadn't gotten married. I was a single.
So you found your wife here in
Taiwan. Oh, I found my wife in Sunday school. Hint, hint, everybody. Go to Sunday school. You may find important truths and your spouse in Sunday school. That's a much better place to meet a spouse than the local bar, by the way.
Right.
Higher quality, you know. Well, okay. You know what? They're wonderful people in bars. Jesus loves those people too. But I think, you know, Sunday school is a wonderful place to meet your spouse. In this case, I was teaching an adult English language Bible study for Chinese folks, Taiwan folks who are learning English and wanted to learn the Bible.
And, what church was that?
Friendship Presbyterian Church.
Okay, and that's the one that you became an elder at, right?
That's right.
Oh, okay.
I was a deacon at this time, doing Sunday school classes, and helping out, and in fact, leading Sunday morning worship sometimes, and also Sunday school classes. I was sick with that. And many adults in the Sunday school class. But there was this young lady, and she was kind. I would ask questions, and you could hear crickets. And after a few crickets, she'd raise her hand,
awesome.
And she would answer the question correctly.
Hmm.
I knew she was the right one because she had the right answers.
Right.
She had the right answers. And she also liked me, the fool that she was. She liked me. She thought I was really a good guy. Because like once I was kind of sick, and I still came to do Sunday school just because I thought it was important. And she was touched by that. And
Definitely.
And so she and I dated one another for 5 years and then finally got married.
That's great.
You see, I had to wait a little bit. You see, at the time I was a deacon, and there was this meeting. The pastor called me and said, we have a problem.
Oh?
Yeah, the elders, they have a problem. There's a problem.
Hmm.
And they want to talk with you about this problem. And I'm like, okay. What, did I offend someone?
Hmm.
And they said, well, I've got some good news and some bad news, the pastor said. I said, well, okay, tell me the bad news. Well, they want you to resign as deacon.
Hmm.
Oh, dear. They don't want you to be a deacon anymore. And they said, but the good news is they want you to be an elder.
Nice.
I could have punched him. You know. He told me on the phone, right? And so anyway, so they called me in and they asked me if I was interested in serving in the role of an elder.
That's
because
great.
They saw how I was doing very elder-like things.
Right.
I was dealing with the spiritual care of people in the congregation. And they viewed that as something in the purview of the elders.
That's great.
And I was only, I was only 20-something years old. Mm. Maybe 27 or 28 at the time.
Yeah.
So I wasn't that old.
Yeah. Experienced, but still yet very young. Yeah.
In the prime of life. Not like now, Mr. Old Man. And so I was an elder. I was ordained as an elder in the Presbyterian Church. And I discovered that's a lifetime position.
Yes.
When you're ordained, you're not unordained. Now, there is a candidacy an office of an elder who's an active elder. That's the word, active elder. When you're an active elder, you're actually approved by the congregation to serve over a certain time period. And then at the end of the time period, there's an election, and then you serve again. If you're crazy enough to agree to do that.
Yeah. It's a lot of work.
Most elders will serve a few times.
Yeah.
I think what they do...
And they become inactive, right?
They become inactive until they get, you know, coerced into becoming active again. Because mostly the session works on trying to get elders to please come back and help. Please! Because it's hard work. And it's a lot of, you know, I recall my wife being really unhappy because I was at a session meeting until like 1 or 2 in the
morning.
Yeah, those
were long meetings.
You know, because there were issues, you know, and I didn't call her. And so she's like worried and she was really ticked off that I didn't call her.
Yeah.
She was right to be.
Now you just give a quick text.
That's true. It's different now.
And then you save the like a pre-formatted text for meetings, and you just shoot
right.
that to them.
That's true.
And then they'll get mad at you for that too. It's like you gotta call me. You can't just give me these copy and paste texts. Yeah.
And so I ended up becoming an elder, and I was an elder for two years probably before I got married. And it was nice to be married in the church as an elder. I mean, it felt pretty good.
Yeah.
It was kind of fun. And at that time, I was also, as I said before, kind of doing the work of kind of organizing the worship ministry. And so I'd get team. We'd have several teams. Usually, we had two, maybe three teams if we were lucky. And each team would have a week, and there'd be a rotation. And then I'd try to help them to make sure they were. Had all the resources they needed and try to get them to see my vision for how to do worship, which they rarely saw. But I always wanted the worship team to know what the pastor was talking about. So they would choose
coordination.
That's right. So they would have a theme and they would try to follow that theme. And they would have certain components in there, like we'd have a Lord's Prayer, we'd have a prayer of confession, and we'd have maybe the Apostles' Creed or maybe some other creed or something.
Yeah.
Try to include those things somewhere in there, you know, however you want to do it, you know. And initially they go like going, what? But they kind of grew into it over time. And so they would choose very different music than I would choose. I mean, I tended to go with the hymns. Although, I did not grow up with the hymns. I grew up with praise songs. So I was very familiar with, and I learned to really worship with great fervor in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship back in university. And it's all praise songs. Some really good praise songs that maybe someday will become a hymn. But then when I started to lead worship, I got hold of a good hymn book, the Trinity Hymnal. And boy, if there are not some great hymns in there. Sometimes the older, the greater. There's some awesome hymns in there. And I discovered that some of the hymn tunes will work with different hymns whose tunes I don't know. Wow, that's a thought.
Well,
that worked out.
Transition tunes.
Yeah, so I'd switch tunes because I didn't know that tune.
I wanted to ask, going back to your role as an elder, one of the questions I have here is, what does an elder do? Now, you explain what an elder does already, but in the Presbyterian Church, what is the difference between the function of an elder and the function of a pastor? Like, in my background, in my last church, an elder is pretty much a pastor, but he's unpaid. And the pastor functions more in the area of preaching. So it's almost like a teaching elder, right?
Precisely. That's precisely right.
Oh, that's what it
is. In Presbyterianism, we have ruling elders, like me, and teaching elders, like the pastor.
Okay.
And generally speaking, the pastor is a teaching elder, but he's a non-voting elder. So usually the ruling elders, they vote on the matters, and the teaching elders, pastor and whoever is an assistant or associate pastor, they're also there to give input. But it's actually the ruling elders who rule. Now, mind you, there's always this sense that the session is supposed to be one in spirit, and that's the Holy Spirit. So there really isn't supposed to be any politics going on. No, I say supposed to, because maybe
there's always
are.
Politics.
But I would have to say that if the session is sincere, I think that's not going to be a big issue. There really isn't going to be an issue where some elder, generally speaking, where some elder is on a power trip, or where a pastor's on a power trip. And it is true in Presbyterianism, the elders call the pastor. Well, sorry. The elders will nominate a pastor and interview a pastor and reach out for a pastor and then nominate him to the session, to the congregation, for the congregation to call a pastor.
Okay.
So the pastor doesn't call himself.
Right.
The session, the elders, the congregation calls the pastor, but the session actually sets it all up.
Okay.
They're the ones who go out. They run the pastoral search committee.
They do
all the interviews, and they invite the pastor to come preach, and or however it's going to work, and whatever needs to happen to find a pastor, the session is in charge of. And so I guess you could say they're running the show, as it were, although the congregation certainly
if the congregation doesn't like the pastor, certainly they can.
Right, right.
They'll probably address the elders. They'll probably share with the elders, but we don't feel comfortable with this. And hopefully the elders are smart enough to hear God's direction in that.
Well, what is the reason why the pastor is not a voting elder? Is it because he's being paid and then they feel that in order to not be inappropriate with his power, he shouldn't have a vote because he's being paid?
I think there's an inherent conflict of interest.
Okay.
How the church resources get spent is sometimes... Now, of course, the session doesn't really want to deal with that, but sometimes they have to because they're beholden to the congregation.
Hmm.
And so the session... The elders are responsible to oversee the deacons in their spending of funding and to oversee the other areas of ministry and how it spends funding.
Hmm.
And so the session deals with those issues. And usually when we deal with the issues, we do get input from the pastor and associate pastors. But when votes come, they generally leave the room.
Okay.
Now, I'm sharing what our church's governance was like. Other Presbyterian churches were probably similar, but I suspect not the same.
Hmm.
So
there's no standard polity for all Presbyterian churches?
Well, I mean, the big picture is the same.
Okay.
The session, generally speaking, is... The idea is, like in a Baptist church, it's like the pyramid, right?
Right.
So you've got the congregation and you've got the church... staff and deacons and then the pastor.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, in a Presbyterian church, that's the apex is not the pastor. It's more like this, right?
Mm-hmm.
You've got the congregation. Well, I guess it is narrower, but it doesn't come to a point. There's no single person in charge. You have all the important decisions are voted on by the session.
Mm-hmm.
Some sessions, some boards of elders might give a vote to the pastor. Ours didn't.
Hmm.
And I think it's not atypical because the person who's being hired to be pastor, he's naturally going to be real concerned about making decisions which are going to improve his financial position.
Right, right.
I mean, that can happen. For instance, if a pastor really wants more people to come so that he can maybe get a bigger salary,
mm-hmm.
well, you know, we really don't want him in the position to be making decisions which are going to lead to him having a bigger salary.
Okay, got it.
Now, is that true for all Presbyterians? I don't think so, but it was true for us.
Okay, yeah, that's something that I didn't know about the Presbyterian Church, which is why we're doing this interview, so that I can know more as well. Okay, you know what, we'll skip this one, because this one doesn't really relate. What do you do for work right now? But we can, because I want to stick with the Presbyterian understanding. But in terms of that word, Presbyterian Christianity,
uh-huh.
right? Like, can you tell us, how is that similar or different from other denominations of Christianity? Like, what are its distinctives? Like, you shared about the hierarchy and the organization of it. You shared about the difference between elders and pastors and deacons. But when you go to a Presbyterian church, when people think about Presbyterianism, what makes Presbyterianism different than other types of Christians?
Well, Presbyterianism is kind of old. It goes back to John Knox and I think Calvin. I think Calvin is part of the roots of Presbyterianism. And all that's based on Reformation stuff. And you know the five solas, right?
Mm-hmm.
The five solas. Sola Scriptura means only Scripture. Why is that a significant one? Well, in the Catholic Church, the authority was considered to be a stool with three legs.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the legs was Scripture. One of the legs is church tradition. Another one is the church official. So they had three, like the Pope.
Right.
But they had three legs to that chair. In the Reformation and in Presbyterianism, it's strictly sola scriptura, meaning Scripture is the only authority by which decisions should be made. All right, sola scriptura. Then there's sola Christus, meaning only Christ, meaning trusting in Christ is the only way to heaven. And we follow only Christ. He's the head. That kind of goes back to anti-papism, that Christ is the leader of the church. We follow Christ. That's the second one. Third, sola gratia. Only by grace are we saved. We're saved by grace, not by any works of our own.
only by grace. So as we said earlier, you know, you got to be perfect to get into heaven. No one's perfect. It's only by God's gracious willingness to forgive us because of the payment of our sins on the cross by Jesus' death that we can, for ourselves, take that opportunity and be saved. Only grace. Sola gracia. And then there's sola fide. That's number four. Sola fide. Only faith. Meaning we have to have faith in God to save. That's kind of like grace. I'm not sure if I'm explaining these things adequately.
Right.
Because grace isn't meant to be the same as faith.
Right.
But one of the solas is sola fide. Only faith. Meaning only by faith in Christ and His ability to save us are we saved.
I think it's also because grace comes before faith in the understanding of
That's right.
God's sovereignty.
That's right.
In Calvinism.
That's where you get irresistible grace.
Right. Yeah.
By the way, my wife's name is Grace, and is definitely she's definitely irresistible. So it was very easy for me to be a Calvinist.
There it is.
So she's quite irresistible. Irresistible grace. And that was four solas. The fifth sola is only for the solus Deo Gloria.
Okay.
Or sola, I'm not sure if I'm getting this mixed up. Is it Deo Gloria or Gloria? Maybe it's solus glory, Gloria Deo. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Because I'm not good in Latin.
Sure.
Better with the Greek. Anyway, which means only God's glory.
Okay.
Okay, so
right.
The idea is that we should be doing all things, everything we do should be done for God's glory.
Mm-hmm.
And that should be the guiding principle. And those five solas are alive and well in Presbyterianism in its reformed state. As I said, reformed Presbyterianism. Because there are other forms of Presbyterianism that are not reformed. Reformed are based on those five solas
right.
and the five points of Calvinism. Okay, that's reformed Presbyterianism. The tulip, total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and she is, and the perseverance of the saints. Okay, these five solas and these five points of Calvinism, they make up reformed or orthodox Presbyterianism. Now, there are other Presbyterians that are a bit soft on those. There are two very large branches of Presbyterianism in the United States. There's the Presbyterian Church of the USA, PCUSA.
Yeah, very popular.
Very popular and very liberal and not very orthodox and not reformed. I'm not one of them. And then there's the PCA, or the Presbyterian Church of America, which is reformed and they follow those, you know,
okay.
10
and
points.
The PCA split from the PCUSA because
right.
of certain conservative liberal issues, right?
Right.
So the PCUSA would not hold to TULIP and the five solas?
I don't think they hold to the Bible.
Okay.
That's cruel. I'm sorry. Any PC.
And so therefore, it wouldn't follow any of those 5 points.
That was
either
wrong.
Hand, right?
That was wrong, but please forgive me. There are Christians in the PCUSA.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry.
You're making a joke, right?
But it was a cruel joke.
It's a hyperbole.
It was wrong. I was sinning. I was sinning. I admit. I was sinning. Okay.
But if anyone could make a joke about that, it would be you.
Okay.
Right? It's like, well, I can make Baptist jokes and get away with it, but if I make Presbyterian jokes, probably I wouldn't get away with it as
and, you
much.
Know, there's a great Baptist preacher who is very reformed.
Oh, Spurgeon, right?
Well, he's one.
Oh, okay. You weren't thinking of Spurgeon.
I wasn't thinking, but he is one.
Okay.
Okay. In fact, Spurgeon was the one who was being asked. He was being asked by those around him. This is a great quote. You got to remember this. Okay, people were asking Spurgeon. This is like newspaper reporters. Because he was getting kind of popular. And they were saying, Sir, Mr. Spurgeon, sir, when you get to heaven, what are you going to say is your greatest contribution to your salvation? And without skipping a beat, he said, the greatest contribution to my salvation is my sin, which made it so very necessary.
There you go.
Yeah. That was his response. That's a very Reformed answer.
Yeah.
He did not claim that he had any goodness or any greatness to qualify him for entrance into heaven.
Right.
Another great Reformed quote is from White. What's White's first? George Whitehead? Does that name sound familiar? George Whitehead?
I'm thinking of George Whitfield. But
okay. His name's Whitehead. Or maybe Whitfield. Maybe I'm wrong.
I don't think it's Whitfield.
He's a contemporary of Charles Wesley. A contemporary of Charles Wesley.
Oh. Well, contemporary meaning he's the
same time period.
Yeah, that's Whitfield.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whitfield. George Whitfield?
Yeah, George Whitfield.
Okay. So George Whitfield was asked to comment on the death of Charles Wesley. Great preacher, Charles Wesley. And of course, everyone knew that Charles Wesley was not Reformed.
Mm-hmm.
And they all knew that Whitfield was.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes they traded barbs over the years. And so they asked Whitfield, they said, "Do you believe you will see Wesley in heaven?" It's hard to say this without breaking up. And Whitfield said, "No, I don't. Because he will be so much closer to the cross than me, I won't be able to see him."
Hmm.
What a great response.
Yeah.
I want to cry when I hear him say that. Because he realized that you don't all have to be under the same umbrella to be saved. You don't have to be Reformed and Calvinist. You don't have to hold the five solas, although I think it's a great idea. You don't have to do that. The umbrella of Christian salvation is broad enough for Charles Wesley.
Yes. And Charles Wesley knew everything about Calvinism that Whitfield did. He just didn't agree with it. But then the person on their deathbed who doesn't know anything about Christianity except that Jesus can save him from his sins, and he accepts. I mean, he doesn't know anything about Calvinism or the solas, but he's saved. The thief on the cross.
Yeah.
You know, 1,500 years before Calvin was even born.
Exactly.
So.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. So the Bible is broad enough to accept many different denominations. Yeah.
And by the way, Calvin wasn't a perfect man. He had his own foibles.
Hmm.
He had his own arrogance. He had his own way of doing things. I happen to agree with his theology, but some of his actions were a bit over the top. For instance, he is said to have drowned someone who did not agree with his theological... what happened was the area that he was living had switched over from Protestantism to Catholicism. And everyone turned to Catholicism and what do they call it? Well, just Catholicism.
Yeah, the Papists.
Papists, right? They become Papists. And his response was to take one of those guys and drown him. And it's like, well, no, I don't agree with that. You know, And a lot, that happened a lot when people switched sides often. That was the result.
That kind of thing was sort of, I don't want to say normal, but when you don't have separation of church and state, I mean, it's like, when you have the wrong theology, that is criminal, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay, well, let me take it up a notch in terms of the distinctives, because you're talking about Reformed Presbyterianism, original Presbyterianism being Reformed. Well, there are different Reformed denominations, like, for example, Lutheranism is a Reformed branch. You have the Reformed denomination, okay, by itself, which is different than Presbyterianism, because I think it's different than John Knox.
Anyone could be Reformed.
Yes.
And Reformed usually means Calvinist, five points, and the five solas, that kind of thing.
Okay. So if that's the case, then would the difference between Presbyterianism, Reformed, and Lutheran be the way they do their polity and how they conduct their church in terms of its hierarchy?
I would argue that the Reformed part is more to do with theology, but the way church governance is more to do with the actual denomination.
Okay.
I wanted to say, before I forgot, there's this awesome pastor in Washington State who wrote a great book called Desiring God, The Meditations of a Christian Hedonist.
That's right.
I love it. I love to say, I'm a Christian
That's
hedonist.
Right.
And people go, what?
Yeah.
I am. Okay, but it's not what you think. In any case...
Spiritual hedonist.
That's right.
Yeah.
And
for some reason, I'm having a senior moment and I can't recall his name.
Piper.
John Piper. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
John Piper is a Reformed Baptist.
Hmm.
And so even though church governance is very different in a Baptist church from a Presbyterian church, the theology, I suspect, is almost identical.
Hmm.
I would say his theology, because I hear him talk all the time and I go, right on.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I pretty much have very Presbyterian theological views. And so maybe I should rephrase. I have very Reformed theological views.
Mm.
And Piper does too. Mm. So one can be a Baptist and be Reformed.
Mm. Let me ask a question that I never really got a good answer from. And I have a friend named Joel. He's a Presbyterian. And he even admitted this because I had him come over to my church and share about Presbyterianism and its doctrines, its distinctives. And this church is more, it's non-denominational, okay? But pretty much it's run like a Baptist church.
It's a congregational church, I guess.
Yeah, pretty much
right.
Like that.
The pastor's the boss.
Yeah.
And the church, technically, they agreed to have him be boss.
Yeah, it's sort of, it's a little different, okay?
Oh,
but sort of in that vein, okay? And he even said, and I'm proud of one of my students because I didn't urge my student to say this, but during the question and answer time, the student said, you know what, infant baptism, right? Like, if you say that it's about faith, grace through faith, but then you still practice infant baptism, how does that work? And then my friend Joel, being the guest speaker, he said, well, you know, he equivocated. He's like, I also, and me and a lot of my friends also don't know why that's still there, and we prefer not to, but it's sort of a carryover from
I have a better answer. I have a better answer.
Okay, go for it.
Presbyterianism, or maybe Reformedisms, they look to the Old Testament in this regard. They look at the sign of being a part of God's people. Circumcision is the sign in the Old Testament of being a member of God's community, of God's people. Being, it's like the stamp of being a member of God's people. It does not mean you're saved.
Mm.
And in the Old Testament, a circumcised guy might be struck down for his own sin. You know, it's not the same as salvation.
Mm.
It's membership. It's a mark of membership in God's community.
Mm.
It's a, and so in Presbyterianism, baptism is not for salvation. Absolutely not. It does confer a association with God's people that does not extend to salvation. But Presbyterians do believe that if you are baptized, you will have benefits, even if you're not yet saved. Presbyterians believe that there is a kind of a contract between the congregation and the person being, and God and the person being baptized. And the contract is that the congregation is going to help this person to come to know Christ and to come to believe in Him.
Oh, okay. So the baptism becomes sort of like the godparents.
You could say that.
The contract of
in
godparenthood.
Fact, Presbyterianism doesn't like to have a person get baptized just him and the pastor. To them, that's a non sequitur. That doesn't make sense. Because it's the congregation is supposed to be a witness to this, and they're supposed to take vows. The congregation takes vows to
wow.
help this person grow in their faith.
Hmm.
So the idea of I grew up a Baptist,
yeah.
all right? And so what's the mantra? What's the Baptist mantra? The Baptist mantra.
What's the Baptist mantra? You're
yeah,
asking me.
That's right. Can you tell me what it is?
Baptism
is an outward sign
oh, yeah.
of an inward change.
Right. It's an outward sign of the inward conversion.
Right.
Yeah.
An outward sign of an inward change. The Presbyterians don't believe that.
Mm.
They don't believe that baptism is an outward sign of an inward change. The Presbyterians believe it's an outward sign of God working on this person and through the congregation. That's why they baptize babies.
So it's a communal, it's almost like a communal ceremony that symbolizes we want you to become a Christian and we're going to help you.
That's right.
Okay.
It's a solemn promise of the congregation and the parents
to raise this child so that someday the child could believe in Christ. Hmm. With a belief that God is also part of this contract. That God is going to pour His Spirit into this situation, into this community, to help make that happen. That's why Presbyterians baptize infants.
Okay. Now, as a Baptist, my question is, so, from a Baptist perspective, once they actually believe in Christ, do they get baptized again? Or it's retroactive from the baptism that they had as a baby?
Presbyterians believe that the first command, or the first action a believing Christian must take, or should take, is to be baptized.
Okay.
That's what Jesus said. Believe and be baptized.
Correct.
And so, when someone comes to faith, then the Presbyterian says, you need to get baptized.
Also to get baptized again?
No, they do not.
Awesome. I like this.
Absolutely not.
So it's retro? Like they go back to the baby baptisms? And
I'm already
okay.
Good. Let me explain this a little better.
Okay.
All right, I didn't explain it well enough. If an adult who's not a Christian comes to faith, The Presbyterians will say, do not delay your baptism. Believe and be baptized.
Okay.
Do it.
Because you haven't been baptized.
Because you haven't been baptized.
As a kid. Okay.
The Presbyterians believe that baptism, it does confer benefit, not salvation.
Right.
They do believe it confers benefit. The action of the Holy Spirit is commonly spoken of. Okay?
Okay.
So there is the presence of God, not in the heart of the person per se, but the presence of God is there with the parents, helping to bring, and the congregation, helping to bring this infant into God's kingdom.
So, but is it a sacrament, or it's more of something between a sacrament?
It's a sacrament.
Okay.
It's a sacrament.
With the Catholic sense of the word, or the Protestant sense of the word?
It's not a Catholic sacrament.
Okay.
Or not a sacrament in the Catholic sense. A Catholic would argue that you cannot be saved unless you're baptized.
Right.
The Presbyterian would argue that, of course, you're not saved when you're baptized, and you won't be saved by being baptized, but you can be saved without being baptized, although you should always get baptized.
Right.
Okay. Because they're saying you should be baptized.
Right.
Because you are in God's presence with God's people, enjoying all the benefits that come from that, which is going to increase your chance of believing a whole lot.
Okay.
It's like steroids or something, you know? It's
being
hard.
Being baptized is the steroids to your spiritual growth.
Right, exactly.
Or spiritual, not revival, birth. Yes.
And that's why Presbyterians are very eager to baptize their children.
Okay.
They're very eager to do it because they want their child to be in that relationship with God's Holy Spirit, the church, and them, the parents.
Okay, but when the child actually believes, like in his heart, they don't get baptized again, right?
And there's a reason.
Okay, why?
Because in baptism, you see... A Baptist view is that baptism is a choice made by a believer to demonstrate their faith in Christ publicly through baptism.
Correct.
And I think Baptists would not disagree with that statement.
I mean, Presbyterians would not.
No, Baptists would not disagree with that.
No, no.
I think my characterization is fair.
That is true, yes.
But a Presbyterian doesn't actually view baptism that way.
Okay.
Presbyterianism views baptism as an act of God to mark a person as being part of God's people.
Oh, okay. Then that means you already answered the question.
So yeah, that means that when a child, an infant is baptized, he's marked, just like circumcision.
Right.
He's marked as one of God's people. That doesn't mean he's saved, but it does confer benefit.
Right.
The benefit of being spiritual benefit. And Presbyterians believe this, that when a person is baptized, especially an infant, they are in a beneficial condition. They're not saved. But the Presbyterians do certainly believe they're more likely to end up saved.
Yeah, yeah.
And they want to increase that opportunity every way they can. So parents are going to want to get their babies baptized right away. And on the Baptist side, they do the same thing. They just don't call it baptism.
Right.
They call it infant... What do they call it?
Baby dedication.
Baby dedications. Yeah. But again, there's this...
But it is different because we actually don't believe that
God is
the spirit. There's some sort of half semi quasi sacramental thing that's going on.
Right.
It literally is just a symbol. But then the similar thing of we want the whole entire community to be encouraging to this family for the spiritual rebirth of this child, or birth of this child is still there. Yeah.
I think in many ways, practically speaking, it accomplishes the same goal.
Yeah, the function is
similar. The function is similar. But I would say that Presbyterians feel a little more secure to have their babies baptized.
Yeah.
Because they believe that that's actually going to help make sure their child is going to end up believing in Jesus someday. And they really want their child to believe in Jesus someday.
Understood.
That's why they do it. Yeah. That's the only reason why they do it. Okay. But that's a big reason. That's the reason, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
And it's very important. A Presbyterian will always want to baptize their child. They'll be worried if they don't.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Because that actually shows that's a really big distinctive between Baptist and Presbyterianism and non-denominational churches. Because most Baptist and non-denominational churches will not have that view. Whereas I think Lutherans and Presbyterians and Reforms have that view. Lutheran even harder, because it's almost like a Catholic sacrament. Even though they deny.
Chris, Lutheranism is Catholicism without the Pope, isn't it?
Yeah. So it's like a light.
I'm sorry, light I didn't mean that. I'm sorry, I take that back.
Anglicans as well. Yeah.
Well, indeed.
Yeah, yeah.
But I would say about sacraments, you know that Presbyterians and Baptists and Protestants on the whole don't believe in transubstantiation. Mm-hmm. However, Presbyterians do accept that it's not just a symbol.
Yeah, well, what is the word for that? It's not it's consubstantiation.
Perhaps.
Yeah, with the substance.
Right.
But not transformed.
Presbyterians do believe that it's mysterious and it's a work of God. Just like, that's how they feel about baptism. That baptism is also a mysterious work of God.
They do, yes.
That is different than a Baptist might say. A Baptist might say, no, it's a person's choice and it's their outward sign of an inward change. And a Presbyterian would say, I don't feel that way. I think it's more than...
There's definitely more...
And that's why a Presbyterian pastor would probably never baptize someone who had been baptized before. Mm. A Reform Presbyterian pastor would probably never do a second baptism.
Mm.
Because he would feel like... He'd say, what, the first one wasn't good enough?
That's what the Baptist would actually say. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the first one wasn't good enough? I mean, come on. God did it. It's an act of God. See, that's the thing. Presbyterians would say that baptism is primarily an act of God, not an act of man, although men are involved. And Baptists would say it's primarily an act of God, although God is involved. I'm sure Baptists would say God is involved.
Of course.
But the emphasis is reversed. So in Presbyterianism, they would say, again, that God is the primary mover. In the Baptist view, they would say probably the person is the primary mover because it's their choice. Mm-hmm. They make a choice and it's a beautiful thing when they share with the community of the faith or whomever.
Yeah.
They share this visible sign of an inward change, and it's a beautiful thing. And the same would be true for an adult in Presbyterianism.
Right.
Now, mind you, so when an infant gets baptized in the Presbyterian church, they are considered a member of the church and a member of, you know, God's people, but they're not saved.
Right.
And so it's the job of the church.
Can you share that? Because it seems that, biblically speaking, a member of a church is someone who is saved. So how is it possible to be a member of the church without actually believing yet in the church and in the leader of the church, which is Christ?
Well, you know, I mean, you could say the same thing about in the Baptist church. Mm-hmm. I mean, couldn't the children of a member be part of that church? And of course they are.
Oh,
right?
No, but we would make a distinction, like they're not members of the church.
In Presbyterianism, they're not voting members.
Okay, so they're members but they can't vote.
Right,
okay.
They're non-voting members, just like a pastor.
That's so funny. I'm sure there's a lot of jokes about that. Well, it is, because we're laughing about it right now. It probably is a meme or something about Presbyterian distinctives.
Yeah. And there are Presbyterian pastors who don't like that and have actually managed to get a change.
I'm sure there are.
I'm sure there are some Presbyterian pastors who have changed the governance of their church to make them voting members.
Yeah.
I can believe
Presbyterian
that.
Light.
That's right. but certainly, on the Presbyterian side, they'll view a person as a member, whether or not they're a believer.
Hmm.
They're two different distinct. Now, as an adult, they're not going to let... The session is responsible, by the way, for accepting new members. Well, no, I apologize. The Board of Elders is required to interview people who want to become members and to interrogate them. The standard question is, and you should have a good answer for this, those of you who are watching. After you've died and you're standing at the gates of heaven and St. Peter asks you, by what reason should I let you come in?
Right.
Your answer had better not be, because my parents go to church, or because I go to church, or because I gave money to the church, or because I do good things, or because, you know, I did more good than that. That had better not be. And no Presbyterian elder is going to let you become a member of the church if you say that. They might send you right back to catechism class.
Yeah, gotta go back to
because the proper answer,
and
I'm gonna tell you this, don't forget. The proper answer is because you trust in Jesus to save you from your sin. That is the reason why you can get into heaven and no other. And no other.
Amen.
That's definite. That's Presbyterianism in a nutshell.
Let's add to this question, but shift gears and talk about Presbyterianism in Taiwan. So, you've been an elder in a Presbyterian church in Taiwan. You know the Taiwan culture. You've been here longer. You married a Taiwanese woman. What is Taiwanese Presbyterianism, and how has it influenced Taiwan? And has the Presbyterian church been influential in Taiwan in a good or a bad way, from your opinion?
I'm no great expert on the history of Presbyterianism in Taiwan, but I do believe that the Presbyterian Church in Taiwan got its start before the split in the United States. So I believe the Presbyterianism in Taiwan is more of the PCUSA variety than the PCA variety. And so I don't consider the Presbyterian Church in Taiwan as particularly reformed.
Okay.
And so I don't expect them to act in the same way as I would expect a Reformed church to act.
Okay. And you were, but here in Taiwan, you were part of...
Of an independent Presbyterian. Okay.
So they weren't really connected to...
Right. That's true. That's okay. True. The church where I was ordained to be an elder was part of an independent Presbytery. A Presbytery of one.
So yeah, I guess you can do that, huh?
You can do it.
You're not really part of any association.
We had to get special permission, though, to call our pastor. Our pastors come from presbyteries. And the presbyteries have to release the pastor to go from one presbytery to another. And so we had to write to their presbytery and their seminary saying, you know, we're not officially part of PCA, but we do hold their doctrine. We are a Reformed church. But we're in Taiwan, and there is no Reformed Presbyterian church, and we're only one church. So we don't have a presbytery, or I would say we are a presbytery of one. And they check us out about this, and they when they're convinced that our theology is Reformed, then they'll say, yeah, sure, okay, no problem. But that's an issue.
Okay,
an issue. A pastor is not allowed to come over from PCA to our church. They've all been PCA pastors to our church without... our church I'm no longer part of that church, without that church explaining its theological reform status.
Okay. Well, you know, when you go around Taiwan, you see a lot of these hospitals. They're called like McKay Presbyterian Hospitals. You see all the Presbyterian churches around. What is your church's view of all of that? Are you guys connected? Like, do you have members that are connected to those types of Presbyterian churches and movements and organizations?
The presbytery that we are part... my old church, because the new church is a congregational church down the street that I attend because, well, it's right here.
Yeah.
And so, anyway...
Timu Grace, right?
Timu Grace Church.
Yeah.
The Presbyterian church that I was part of, they would try to be involved in Taiwan ministries. So we had a missions program that had a local and an international aspect to it. And so we would try to be involved in medical ministries, if possible, or maybe involved in more often Aboriginal or church planting ministries up in the mountains, that kind of stuff, down in Tainan and stuff like that. They would tend to try to be involved in that. And sometimes there would actually be, sometimes we would be sending members of their congregation to be involved in some kind of church ministry in that capacity. And as I said, also there was involvement with ministries outside of Taiwan, missions, organizations, and individual missionaries, this kind of thing.
Okay.
In fact, we had sent one of the missionaries, we'd actually raised in our own congregation, sent out. We were very excited to be able to do
that. Nice. Where is he or she?
Is it
confidential?
No, it's not confidential. She is in South America.
Oh, okay. Now,
she was in Southeast Asia, and then she was in Europe, and now she's in South America.
Hmm. Cool. Well, it's already an hour and 45-minute interview, if you can believe it. I do want to ask one more question, and then we can close up. And then make it before 2 hours, hopefully. But the last question I have here is, what can other Christians of other denominations learn from Presbyterian Christianity?
I think that one thing that Presbyterians don't do is they don't trust one guy at the top. Hmm. Humans are inherently sinful. And we know, we've all heard, you know, that the Tocqueville statement, absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Don't know if it was Tocqueville, yeah.
Okay, but in any case, a while back, some guy said that. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. And that's true inside of Christianity as it is outside of Christianity. And so in Presbyterianism, we always believe there needs to be checks and balances. You know, there's a board of elders, and there's the pastor and the associate pastor. They're separate. Although, they're supposed to be an association of equals, although I think the session's going to probably, because they call the pastor, and they're the ones, technically the session should be the one seeking the Holy Spirit's guidance and then passing that along to the pastor. Here's what we think that God is saying. Run with it.
Right.
And a lot of pastors are going to say, no way. But so that's church by church. But I would say that Presbyterianism really thinks that it's best not to have too much authority in one place. That distributed authority is maybe the only, the safer way. It limits evil. Okay, so that's why Presbyterianism would not tend to be in favor of fascist or communist dictatorships. Because too much power is concentrated in one place. And so I would say that MAGA folks would probably not be Presbyterian. Probably.
Even though he's a Presbyterian.
In name, he's what we call him, a pino, Presbyterian
name only.
Because I'm sure he doesn't know who Calvin is and what the 5 points of Calvinism or 5 solas or any of that. Doesn't even know
maybe
who Jesus is, frankly.
I'm fascinated because your point of instruction to people who aren't Presbyterian is actually more of a sociological or a psychological type of insight. So nothing like theological or nothing in terms of methods of evangelism or discipleship.
Oh, well, I mean, I can give evangelical statements to be sure, but if someone was comparing Presbyterianism with another ism, like baptism or Baptists or Methodisms or whatever,
yeah.
I would say that Presbyterians tend to distrust all the power in one collected in one spot. Alrighty.
So that would be the main thing that we can learn from that.
From Presbyterianism as opposed to Methodism or Baptist
or
whatnot. But I would say in terms of Presbyterianism and the non-Presbyterian, the non-Christian, I would say that a great message to the non-Christians, non-believers, would be that there is no hope other than Christ. That you can't get to heaven by being good. You can't. That's not possible. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to heaven
but through me. Very exclusive, and no one likes being exclusive, you know, but it's true. That's what Jesus said. And if you're going to become a Christian, that means following Jesus. That means what he says, we agree with. If you are not good with that idea, and I fully expect that you're not good with that idea if you don't believe in Jesus, then it's not going to work. You really do have to believe that the only way to heaven is through faith in Christ. That's the only way. And some would argue, well, you know, don't you have to, you know, do good things? And I said, well, you know, Christians should be doing good things because Jesus calls us to love our neighbor. And who's our neighbor? Our neighbor is anyone with whom we have disagreement. Anyone that we don't like, they're our neighbor. So you should be loving those you don't, Christians should be loving those they don't like. Which is why I'm pretty sure that most of those MAGA folks aren't Christian, because they don't love those that they don't like. And I do want to say that for those who are not believers, I do want to say that God cares about you. He loves you. And he is not interested in you spending eternity away from him. You know, it's interesting. A lot of people say God sets up hell to punish people. The Bible never says that. We are created in God's image. All of us. Every single one of us. We have an eternal existence because of it. We have a choice. Do we want to be with God throughout eternity or not? A lot of people don't want to be with God throughout eternity. I don't want to be with God. So what does God do? Well, God can do nothing. And then when you die and you go to heaven, you're with God. Now, I have a question for you. What do you think happens when you throw a piece of paper into the furnace? It bursts into flame. Fire consumes it. Well, that's what happens to an imperfect being in the presence of a perfect God. God has no interest in that person bursting into flame. Of course, I'm being somewhat metaphoric there. But the person, the imperfect, gets destroyed in the presence of perfection. Otherwise, the perfect becomes imperfect, and that cannot be. God is perfect. He cannot become imperfect, otherwise he's no longer God. So, when the imperfect comes into God's presence, it gets destroyed. So out of God's mercy, he prevents people from being destroyed by withdrawing his presence from a place in eternity, some location over there. God withdraws it because God's presence is pervasive. He's omnipresent. He pulls himself away from some place in heaven so that a person who doesn't want to be with God can actually exist without being destroyed by being imperfect in God's presence. Of course, I'm not perfect. I would be destroyed in God's presence too. But lucky me, I get to be protected by the blood of Jesus. His blood shed to pay for my sin is actually protecting me from being destroyed in God's presence. Thank the Lord. But someone who doesn't want to be with God, doesn't believe in Jesus, doesn't have the benefit of the blood of Christ over them. Jesus Christ, this is also limited atonement, by the way, part of TULIP. TULIP says that Jesus dies to pay the penalty for the sins of those who would believe, not to pay the penalty for the sins of those who wouldn't believe. The argument there is that Jesus would never allow, his death could never be without purpose. His death has infinite value, and so it could never be for no value. Meaning, he could never die for someone and that person not believe and that person not go to heaven. That could not be. That's the idea of limited atonement. The logic, there's a logical argument there. And so that's why, and there are plenty of Christians who disagree with that argument, by the way, but I agree with it, just because I think it makes no sense. But I digress, which is what I've been doing all night. Okay, so the point is this, that God has withdrawn his presence, or perhaps will withdraw his presence from a certain area of what we would call heaven, where he is not in existence, and that's where people would go after they die. But because they're still eternal beings, we're created in God's image. But the place they're going to is a place
without God's love, without God's kindness, without God's joy, without God's, you know, bounty, without God's good health, without God's life, all the wonderful things that we want in this life would not be there. Because all the wonderful things that we like in this life are here because God is here. Every good thing comes from God. So if you don't want to be in God's presence, you're going to be in a place without God's presence. And what's without God? That's darkness, sadness, loneliness, unhappiness, illness, hunger, death, eternal death. There's nothing there that draws my interest. And there should be nothing there that would draw yours. Some people think, oh man, I get to go to heaven with all my friends. Sorry, get to go to hell with all my friends. And we can have a great party all the time. And those folks up in heaven are going to be so bored anyway, sitting on a cloud playing a harp. I got news for you. If you don't believe in Jesus, you're going to go to some place. And I suspect you're going to be all by yourself throughout eternity. That's my suspicion. It's not a pleasant thought, but that's what I suspect is the case. Because there is no fellowship without God's presence. I don't think you're going to have fellowship with anybody. Everything that's good won't be there. So please don't choose to not be with God in heaven. That's a terrible place to end up. God is not willing that anyone should go to hell. It's not his wish. It does happen, but it's not God's wish. Don't let it happen to you.
Well, thank you, Elder Curtis, for that basically preaching.
That's right.
I think you're a good preacher, by the way, not just a teacher. But anyways, if you lasted this long and heard everything all the way up to this point, then I congratulate you. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Sorry about that.